Okay, it's Dave here. I've been working really hard at this project. I'm not going to say what it is, because I don't want to give it away yet, but I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 D1 Minis connected together. All right, you're going to say, what? Connected together? How can that be? Well, they're connected through what's called ESP now. So it doesn't require a router or anything like that to work. And I can pass data from the master to any one of the slaves and retrieve information from any one of the slaves. So right now it is... Yeah, they're all talking to each other. They're all talking to each other. So this guy's telling this guy what to do, and then this guy's telling this guy what to do, and this guy's telling this guy what to do. And then the last one here is the remote control, which has a display on it and a large keyboard with 32 keys, which are here. And okay, I took my 4x4 keypad routine and modified it. So now these are the key in and the key out comes from over here. So I have 4 scan lines, 8 receive lines. That gives me 32 keys. So anyways, yeah, and I didn't have room to mount the D1 Mini on the board, so I just went ahead and put it on the table here. So if I reset it, you'll see it'll rewrite what's in the display and stuff. So yeah, that's what I've been working on. It's getting to be quite a complex program, but I have one for the master, one for all the slaves, and then one for the remote. And other than the ESP Now connection, everything is exactly the same. I've learned a lot, like this number here on the screen. You know, I don't want leading zeros and so on and so forth, and I want it to be, you know, a certain size. So yeah, I've been doing some research. Oh, and yeah, let me remind myself. Yes, remember. And so yeah, I found a function that will take a floating decimal number and convert it into 3 digits in the front, a decimal place, 3 digits in the back, all in one command. I said this a while back that Arduinos are fun, but you know, blinking an LED is, you know, lots of fun. But anyways, I got to retract that statement now, because I've learned a lot about Arduinos, and it is just crazy what you can do with an Arduino. The reason why I say that is because these three here slaves have a interrupt in them, which I didn't think you could do, but you can. You can have up to, I think it said 16 ISR routines. So anyways, each one of these is running the same routine to generate a 52 kilohertz signal. This guy does not have the 52 kilohertz, and neither does the remote. So the remote, so far, this is all I've got connected to it, is just 2 wires for the I2C to run the display. The keypad gets all done through that. So the remote is going to be very, very simple. It's going to run off a lithium battery that recharges through the USB plug. So I haven't done that yet, as you can see, but you know, anyways. And these are all lit up with a blue light underneath each one of them to tell me that they're actually connected. If I unplug one of them, the light goes out, it's no longer connected, And it does not affect what is going on in the system as far as the master is concerned. I've got to add one little thing in there that'll say whether or not the remote or the slave actually received the information, but I haven't done that yet. And the other thing I read up on and I found out is that you can actually receive a whole, like the information that's coming in from the master to the slave is a whole bunch of numbers. And, you know, normally I would make them as ASCII too, but then anybody that, you know, sort of hacks into your system or whatever can see what you're doing through the ASCII 2, plus the ASCII 2 takes up a lot of space. So what I've done is I've actually made a structure, a data structure for the master to slave and then slave back to the master, and it retains, it puts the data, it all depends on how you have it defined in your program, whether it's a floating or an integer or a byte or a string. So you can define that structure and then reproduce it. So in here, it takes the slave out structure and reproduces it three times. So I can send a message from this slave to the number one slave by using the MAC address, which I've got labeled on all these here now. I think I even have one on that one as well. So I know exactly what the location is. So, and you know, there's going to be some pins connected on here, but not very, very many. Right now, the one pin on each of these that I've got assigned to do nothing really is just an output of the actual interrupt timing. So the interrupt timing is the most important part of this project, right? It will, anyways, I'm not going to go into the details right now, but anyways, so there you have it. You have five D1 minis talking to each other about different things and receiving the information. And this I'll do more videos on this. It's just I haven't done a video in a couple days, and I, you know, I don't want people to think that I've died or anything like that, so that's why I'm doing this video, just to, you know, not much I can show you here except for the display. But so that's it in a nutshell. This is what I've been working on. I started out with two of them and then went to three and then four. And then today I added the fifth one, added in the display. So I have the display actually showing information. Right now this guy is sending its information to this guy, and then this guy's repeating it to this guy, and it's showing up on the screen here. So, but yeah, it's really, really neat. I think it's time to put away the pick, whatever, you know. Anyways, I'll still build stuff with the pick, but. So yeah, this is what I've been working on. I just thought I'd tell you all and give you a thumbs up, and also wanted to say Happy New Year to everybody, because I didn't do a video since New Year's Day. So it's been 4 days now. I'm going to upload this in a minute or so, and hopefully people give me a thumbs up and maybe ask me some questions in the comments as to what it is I am working on. But yeah, there you have it. It's working. It's working great. I've got one thing doing something here. I got these three doing the identical thing and answering back to that one, and I've got a display port right here in front of me that is being sent information from the master to it that it receives from these three devices. So pretty cool. Some of it's just repetition, so I'm just repeating this and repeating that in my program, but yeah, it's just, I'm doing a little block at a time. So I don't know if you know, there's a difference between a UNO or a NANO and an 8266. Somehow, when you go to compile the program, anyways, if you come across it, like making a character string, whatever you want to call it, equal to quotes, 1, 2, 3 quotes. If you do it on a NANO with that statement, it'll work fine. If you do it on a 8266, you get an error, and the error drives you crazy. Because this routine here, I had it written for a UNO or a NANO. I mean, a NANO or a UNO worked perfectly. I've got it on a couple devices over there. But when I tried to do it on the 8266, it wouldn't work. It kept giving me that weird error. So there's a solution to it. You got to read the compiler's output and you'll figure it out, but it's pretty easy to do. But anyways, yeah, so that's gonna end this video, and I just wanted to say a happy new year to everybody. Thanks for watching, guys, and stay tuned for the next one.